When we imagine aliens visiting Earth, we often picture an evil crew on a spaceship. Scary, threatening, and weirdly humanoid. But what if aliens end up slipping onto our planet in much smaller and subtler ways, on a microscopic scale, unnoticed? Now, flip that question. When we send spacecraft across the solar system, land on distant asteroids, and bring pieces of them home, how can we be sure we aren't leaving traces of ourselves behind? Traces that future scientists might one day misinterpret as something alien. That's one of the reasons sample return missions are so fascinatingly delicate. When we venture out there to bring a piece of the universe back here, we need to touch without leaving fingerprints. And in the case of asteroid Ryugu, what came back to Earth wasn't just a handful of ancient dust, but a lesson in just how easy it is to confuse what's truly alien with what's all too familiar. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Join me today as we explore why asteroids like Ryugu are so scientifically valuable, how the Hayabusa 2 mission successfully brought home a piece of it, and the hidden threat right here at home that almost ruined the whole thing. Why study asteroids in the first place? Far more than lifeless rocks, they're really more like time capsules. You see, our solar system was created over 4.5 billion years ago. Its planets, moons, and all other celestial bodies are thought to be made from some primordial material, but it's hard to tell what that material may have been just by studying Earth rocks. On Earth, erosion, tectonic activity, and the weather modify the material's physical and chemical properties beyond recognition. That's not the case with asteroids, where this material remains largely unperturbed by time, like a window into the earliest days of our solar system. There's also evidence to suggest asteroid collisions with Earth might have delivered organic compounds to our planet when the conditions for life were just starting to emerge. Asteroids might hold insights we can't get elsewhere about the origins of the solar system and the life in it. Yet, getting to asteroids isn't easy. Most of them are found in the asteroid belt, circling the sun in an orbit between Mars and Jupiter. A trip out there, though it has been done before, would take a long time. Not worth it just to collect a small sample. It is much more efficient to send a spacecraft to an asteroid that crosses Earth's orbit. So that's exactly what the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency, or JAXA, did. In 2010, the Hayabusa mission returned the first ever asteroid samples to Earth. Taken from asteroid Itokawa and weighing less than a gram, it set the stage for the sequel mission, Hayabusa 2. On the 3rd of December 2014, Hayabusa 2 spacecraft launched from the Tanegashima Space Center in Japan. The mission aimed to gain insight into the origin and evolution of the solar system, including the beginnings of life. It would do this by collecting samples from the near-Earth asteroid Ryugu. Discovered in 1999, it measures 900 meters across and comes within 195 million kilometers from the Sun, or 45 million kilometers of Earth's orbit, a quarter of the distance to the asteroid belt. After almost 4 years of travel, Hayabusa 2 arrived at Ryugu on the 27th of June 2018. The spacecraft consisted of an orbiter equipped with instruments, including optical navigation cameras, a near-infrared spectrometer, a thermal infrared imager, and a LiDAR. These tools mapped Ryugu's surface, composition, and thermal properties from an orbital altitude of 20 kilometers. Soon after arrival, Hayabusa 2 deployed two small Minerva 2 rovers, the first to successfully land on an asteroid. Rover 1A and Rover 1B used internal rotating masses to hop in Ryugu's low gravity, capturing images and temperature data of the surface. Soon after, the mascot lander was released. Because Ryugu's gravity was too weak to pull Mascot toward it, the lander was pushed out of the spacecraft by a spring, and then free fell from a height of 51 meters. 6 minutes later, it touched down on the asteroid, bouncing several times before coming to a halt. It operated on Ryugu's surface for 17 hours, collecting magnetic, thermal, and spectroscopic data. A third rover, Minerva 2-2, was released in October 2019, but failed before deployment. Instead, it was released into orbit as a gravitational experiment before crashing into Ryugu 5 days later. Hayabusa 2 retrieved samples from Ryugu during two brief touchdowns in 2019. The first touchdown gathered surface samples, close to the equatorial ridge, by firing a small projectile. The impact ejected surface material into the sampler horn, which then funneled it into sealed containers with the spacecraft's return capsule. The second sample came from firing a small carry-on impactor on touchdown to create an artificial crater and expose subsurface material. The reasoning behind the two sample types was that the surface samples had been exposed to the regular radiation, micrometeoroid impacts, and temperature cycles of space, whereas the subsurface material had been shielded from this cosmic weathering, providing a more comprehensive picture of Ryugu's composition. By November 2019, the spacecraft had everything it needed. With its precious cargo loaded, it wrapped up its time at Ryugu and started the return journey home. Over a year later, in December 2020, Hayabusa 2 emerged above our pale blue dot. As it soared past us, it dropped a landing capsule containing the 5.4 grams of asteroid sample, which parachuted down to a soft landing in South Australia. NASA and Jaxa are sharing samples between the Hayabusa 2 mission and the similar OSIRIS-REx mission, which returned samples of the Bennu asteroid in 2023, maximizing research potential and opportunities for peer review. As the spacecraft continued on its extended mission to another, smaller asteroid, scientists on Earth scrambled to extract and analyze this little piece of our universe's history. The heavy weight of hope was placed on this tiny asteroid sample, and it didn't disappoint. We already knew that Ryugu belonged to the C-type or carbonaceous asteroids, which tend to be found in the outer regions of the asteroid belt, and contain similar materials to those from the time our solar system was formed. But what we didn't know, and to researchers' delight, Ryugu's composition was found to be very similar to a rare class of meteorites known as C1 chondrites. C1 chondrites are the most chemically primitive meteorites known, and are characterized by the presence of carbonaceous material other than pure carbon, like diamond or graphite. They contain chondrules, which are small, round grains that formed in the solar nebula, when our sun was still very young. It seemed Jaxa had hit the nail on the head. Their mission had gotten them up close and personal with the birth of the solar system, just as they had aimed for. Today, Ryugu orbits our sun relatively close to Earth, scraping by at a distance of just 114,000 kilometers at its closest. But it didn't always call this galactic neighborhood home. Using an X-ray technique called Mussbauer spectroscopy, the team put together a timeline of Ryugu's past by meticulously analyzing minute chemical changes in each sample particle fragment. What they found is convincing enough to place Ryugu's origins in the outer solar system. The asteroid's surface properties support this theory. If Ryugu had originated closer to the sun, where temperatures are higher, researchers would expect to see coarser grains. Additionally, the grain fragments are porous. This is exactly what you'd expect to see in asteroids that once held water and carbon dioxide ice. In order for those compounds to be solid, Ryugu's parent body would have been 3 to 4 times farther from the sun than Earth is. Research places Ryugu's formation about 2 million years after the solar system itself. Over the next 3 million years, its parent body lost its ice, leaving behind a hydrated interior and dry surface. About 1 billion years later, a cosmic impact fragmented it. Those fragments eventually coalesced into today's Ryugu. Sample analysis also showed the asteroid contains a rich mix of organic molecules. This is huge, as it implies that the fine-grained surface of an asteroid as old as Ryugu is able to shield organic molecules from the harsh environment of interstellar space. Hiroshi Naraoka of Kyushu University in Japan confirms that these molecules could be transported through the solar system and even be potentially dispersed as interplanetary dust by impacts that eject the uppermost layer of the asteroid. It seems to add weight to the hypothesis that abiotic chemical reactions on asteroids might play a role in creating some of life's ingredients. But beyond just organic molecules, one research team at Imperial College London also found something a lot more exciting. Organic matter. Not exactly life, but rods and filaments similar to the size and shapes of microorganisms here on Earth. If these were true extraterrestrial organisms, it would finally prove that the idea of panspermia, aka that life originating from elsewhere in the universe can survive the transfer between planetary bodies, is possible. But before they shouted alien, the team did what any good scientist would do. They double-checked their work. Space agencies have very tight protocols when it comes to preventing contamination. The Ryugu sample traveled to Earth in a hermetically sealed chamber and was opened in a class 10,000 cleanroom using sterilized tools before being stored in airtight containers under nitrogen. When scientists went to retrieve the sample to begin testing, they first performed an X-ray nanotomography analysis, basically X-ray on steroids. It allows researchers to image internal structures at scales smaller than a micrometer without sectioning or damaging the specimen. This was to check that Ryugu's sample didn't fall prey to any contamination in the process of transferring it from the landing capsule into its storage facility. The results came in. Ryugu's sample was clean. So where did the microorganisms come from? Upon arrival on Earth, the primary Ryugu samples were carefully subdivided into multiple portions in Jaxa's specialized facility. Some remained sealed in their pristine state for future analysis, while others were distributed to different research teams worldwide for immediate study. This standard practice allows scientists to maximize research potential while preserving portions of the irreplaceable material. Subsample A0180, measuring just 1 by 0.8 millimeters, traveled to Imperial College London, where, despite the meticulous protocols and cutting-edge containment systems, the impossible happened. During their first observation by scanning electron microscopy, the researchers noticed something strange. Rods and filaments of organic matter scattered across the sample. Cylindrical and carbon-rich, these specimens were mainly observed on the surface of the sample, though 28% were found within porous cavities. They counted 11 rods and filaments in total, a number which rose to 147 at the second scanning electron microscopy examination 19 days later. Just to be sure, they surveyed common fabrics and fibers in the lab to compare them to these filaments. Hair, clothing, wipes, nothing seemed to match. They paid close attention to the rate of population growth and decline, and concluded that, based on population statistics, the specimens were living and had infiltrated the Ryugu rock after sample preparation. In order to examine a rock under a microscope, the sample must first be cut, ground, and polished to create a flat, mirror-like surface for examination, also known as preparation of the polished block. The research team deduced it was at this point that the rods and filaments appeared, a conclusion supported by the earlier findings of the nano X-ray tomography, which came out clean. This pointed to one explanation. The rods and filaments were likely microorganisms of terrestrial origin. Earthly bacteria had contaminated our pristine asteroid sample. The team didn't attempt to sequence the bacteria's DNA, so we don't know exactly what species it was, but it was likely a single spore of some kind of prokaryote, probably a bacillus, that started forming a colony. Luckily, the team was able to control the spread. Once they repolished the block, the microorganism population disappeared for good, and analysis could go on as planned. Despite the contamination setback, Ryugu's sample had proven incredibly valuable. Combined with NASA's much larger sample from Bennu, which weighed 121.6 grams and arrived in 2023, it had given us a glimpse into the early days of the solar system, and new findings about both asteroids are still coming to light. As we prepare for more ambitious sample return missions, including potential trips to Mars, the stakes get even higher. If we're looking for signs of life, we need to be completely certain we're not finding hitchhikers from our own planet. Space agencies do have planetary protection guidelines in place to minimize the risk of forward contamination, us taking microbes to other planets, and back contamination, setting alien life loose on our planet. And Hayabusa 2 is a great example of how space exploration is as much about the challenges here on Earth as it is about the challenges out there in space. Each mission teaches us something new about our target subjects, as well as our own methods. And despite the unexpected hiccup, Ryugu's ancient material continues to improve our understanding of celestial origins. I'm excited to see what new findings will come out in the next 5 to 10 years. Until then, we'll just have to sit tight. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, you might want to check out my other videos on asteroid Bennu. Until next time. When studying asteroid samples, it all comes down to how well you can analyze the data. But while this might sound like the purview of scientists, it actually isn't that difficult to do. Anyone can analyze data for patterns or trends. If that sounds a little daunting to you, don't worry. The sponsor of today's video, Brilliant, can help. Brilliant is an online learning platform that has thousands of interactive courses covering everything from data analysis to math, science, programming, and AI. I found it really fun to use. Its bite-sized lessons on regression and classification had me classifying penguin data to find correlations in a very interactive way. It was simple, clear, and practical. No wonder Brilliant is found to be 6 times more effective than just watching lecture videos. It helps you develop critical thinking rather than just forcing you to memorize. So whether you're looking to hone your skills or develop new ones, why not give Brilliant a try? Scan my QR code or head to brilliant.org/astrum for a free 30-day trial of everything Brilliant has to offer and 20% off your annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching. I was honestly blown away by the numbers of you that signed up to the Patreon. Like I said in the replies to your DMs on Patreon, everyone here at the Astrum team is so grateful to have such an amazing community. If you haven't joined the Patreon party yet, we're still on our long-term 1,000 patron member drive, so you can go to the link in the pinned comment to become a part of that effort. When you join, you'll be able to watch the whole video ad-free, see your name in the credits, and submit questions to our team. Meanwhile, click the link to this playlist for more Astrum content. I'll see you next time.